we got news that the Freedom From Religion Foundation has settled with the city of Santa Clara, and their cross is being removed from their city park. I think that what religious monuments on city property say to people who aren't part of that religious tendency, whether they be minority religion or non-religious, I think it's a profound message. I think it's inappropriate, and I think it's really great that the city of Albany recognizes that, and it's really great that the city of Santa Clara was forced to give in on that. So, and by the way, FFRF has been saying to us, we'll seriously address the Albany Hill Cross once Santa Clara settles with us. So we may get some real action here. Just last month, or maybe early this month, the city sent a postcard to everyone in Albany explaining their position on the cross. I sent it out in our EBA newsletter, and it explained the position on the cross. It explained that they don't think it belongs there for all the right reasons, but they have a problem because the Lions Club is right ready to aggressively sue. And they actually did the preliminary things of the lawsuit in the beginning of December. And they were actually going after council members, the fire chief, the city manager, you name it. I mean, this guy in the Lions Club, and by the way, Albany Lions Club is headquartered in El Cerrito and Walnut Creek, is ferocious. He is brutal. He's a Donald Trump. And so I think it's going to require some serious intervention to change things, turn them around. So, if anybody would like to sign up for our newsletter, it's on the East Bay Atheist website. Should be links to it in the meetup announcement. Today, we're hosting Robert Ressler, Ph.D. He's formerly an associate professor of evolutionary psychology at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. He now works as a Bay Area creativity and life purpose coach. He has some CDs here, which are based on the ideas and the talk he's going to be giving. I think he can actually sing. I think it's pretty good. I think he was playing a little bit of it earlier. Yeah? Good. It's good to see him. His talk is described as entitled Behind the Fig Leaf, the Roots of Patriarchy in the Garden of Eden. So please welcome Robert.
Well, I also like to welcome you. Thank you for coming on a, what's actually a beautiful Sunday, as it turned out. And I'm glad to have been invited to talk about this material today. It always feels timely to me. It feels especially timely in a way, and I'll say a word about why. We're in a moment, historically and personally, of great apprehension, great anxiety, uncertainty, concern about the future. And oddly enough, concerns about the future are sometimes relieved or enhanced by an understanding of the past. Historians would say an understanding of the past and a familiarity with the past is always an anchor for one's existence. And it seems to be the case for all societies, as Ursula Le Guin said. There are societies that have existed without the wheel, but there are no societies that have existed without stories. And the most important story for most societies is their story of creation, whether that be something that comes from intuition, imagination, science, or wherever. Every culture has an answer that they want, and an answer that they are usually born into that offers them guidance and information about where they came from. Where you come from also says something about where you are now, and where you come from may imply things about the future. So now to talk about the deep past, which is something that's interested me for a long time, is to some people irrelevant. No reason to concern ourselves with the deep past. There's plenty to concern ourselves with at the moment. But I say that that's true. And in addition, to understand the context of our moment and how, in fact, to even deal with that moment, it helps to know how we got here. So that's what we'll talk about. Now, when I was doing science and teaching and doing research, my interest was in what's called now evolutionary psychology. It was quite some time ago. It was before the words evolutionary psychology were put together quite the way they are now. And it was a particular approach to evolutionary psychology that I was working on. It had to do with trying to understand how far back in our evolutionary history something like culture even existed. That is, by culture I mean a non-genetic way of transmitting information from generation to generation. Culture means many things. That's one of the meanings it has. And so the research I was doing was very basic research. It was research with animals, and it was related to the question of whether something that happened to an animal in its lifetime could affect the lives of its offspring, and could affect, in fact, the lives of its offspring's offspring. Now, we know that's true for humans. We know that we have a history, and we are born into a society that's been created by people in the past. And we receive stories about the past that tell us a great deal. We have the stories that are our means of transmission from generation to generation. And obviously, our tradition in the West is very influenced by the stories that we call religious stories. They do address questions of origin. They do address basic questions of human nature. But in our era, there are stories about human nature and the deep past, which come from a different source, and that's from science. And that's what I was interested in the fundamentals of. Now, after I left the university, I didn't expect to ever return to that kind of question. But by chance, I was handed a Bible, which I didn't ask for, and which I wasn't terribly interested in reading. But at one point, I thought, well, this is a part of the story of the society I live in. It's a part of the story that my family was very interested in and very influenced by. So I thought, well, I have time, and I'm going to take a look at it. And pretty soon, I got to the Garden of Eden story. It's right at the beginning, and you can't miss it. And of course, everybody's heard it. And I started reading it, and I had a strange experience of, first of all, remembering that as a child, my mother read it to me when I was something like 5 or 6 years old. I was just learning to read, and she was still reading to me. And I believe she was reading a story to me that basically was a child's version of the Garden of Eden story. And I did not understand what it was about. I especially couldn't understand why God would say it's not good to know the difference between good and evil. Because I heard that that was one of the main points of the story, and that it wasn't a good thing. And that made no sense to me. And I read the story carefully enough to reach a conclusion that surprised me, which was, wait a minute, what if, or at least have an idea. And that was, what if these words, which I know are an English translation of something that was written in Hebrew, what if these words are a translation that isn't a faithful translation or accurate translation about what that language, Hebrew, was saying? I didn't understand Hebrew. I couldn't read Hebrew. But I thought the story might make more sense if I knew what the words good and evil meant in the story of the Garden of Eden. What they were based on, what were the original words? And what might the people who wrote the story and the people who originally heard the story, what they might have taken from it that made sense. And what I'm going to do now is read a little bit of something that I wrote about this and its relevance to our time today. But before I do that, I'm going to mention two quotes which have something to say about the place of our stories about the past. One is a quote by the poet Muriel Rukeyser. And she said, "The world is made of stories, not atoms." That's what a poet can say and what a poet can see in the fewest words imaginable. And it's not an anti-scientific statement. It's a meta-scientific statement, in fact. It's a statement about our rationality and how it's based on stories. And the other quote is from George Orwell, who said, "Who controls the past controls the future." And it's in the spirit of that that I see tremendous importance in our understanding of our past. And to my surprise, I felt there was something eventually that I would be able to say that made sense to me of that Garden of Eden story. So let me start by doing a little reading here. Here's another quote. This is by Ernest Becker, who a number of years ago was a well-known social critic and sociologist and philosopher. He said, "Men cause evil by wanting heroically to triumph over it." And I think we can say that we've observed that kind of thing in our own lifetime. When in his 2002 State of the Union message, the President of the United States identified Iraq as a member of an axis of evil, the Bush administration was seeking to frame its war on terror as a stark choice between good and evil, a modern phase of the primordial battle between God and Satan that began in the Garden of Eden. The administration was deliberately speaking in biblical terms, designed to marshal its fundamentalist Christian political base. Yes, the biblical framing of its war on terror was a tawdry misuse of religion in the service of a reckless foreign policy. But not only that, even the deeply embedded and widely accepted narrative of good versus evil that the administration invoked is based on a centuries-long succession of political framings and distortions of religious history and biblical meaning. And I arrived at that conclusion after I saw other translations of the Garden of Eden story than the one that's approved by the Christian Church. In fact, translations into English by Jewish scholars who are steeped in the Hebrew language and are scholars of ancient Hebrew and of the Israelite society out of which the story originally came. So, the good versus evil narrative doesn't faithfully represent the original Garden of Eden creation myth. To be sure, evil presented itself as a word perfectly suited to that president's Iraqi target, evoking in the minds of a predominantly Christian electorate images of a satanic threat in paradise. Because, of course, Iraq is the place that corresponds to the Eden story. The Tigris and Euphrates River are named in the Bible story. Now, the President Bush wasn't the only president who made reference to the struggle between good and evil. So did our now departing president, Barack Obama, in his Nobel Prize speech, where he won the Nobel Prize. He said he recognizes that evil exists in the world. And I know what he meant by that, or I think I know what he meant by that, and we all believe we know what he meant by that, because some terrible, terrible things clearly happen in the world. and one would be a fool to deny that they do. But there's something special about the concept of evil, because it implies that it is a force in opposition to the force of God and the control of God in the world, which is designed to undermine the control of God and thwart the triumph over God's will. And all of that language, where it's God against Satan, good against evil, has some pretty serious consequences for how people think about each other. The word evil directs a blinding moral spotlight on its target. It obliterates shades of gray. It casts the wider context into darkness. It throws the complexities of history, the likelihood of unintended consequences, and the suffering of innocence all into the shadows. The use of this blindingly prejudicial term also helps make the one who points it invisible to the moral scrutiny of others. Evil represents, after all, the metaphysical force that would presume to defeat the will of God. The one who points that spotlight appears to do so on God's behalf. You call someone else evil, you claim to be speaking for God. If God is seen by most of the people who listen as the ruler of the universe, you're entitled to do almost anything to that enemy. And we see that happening again and again. The enemy is demonized, the enemy is dehumanized, and all of this promotes violence and savagery in the world. We see it on all sides. We also see it outside of the Christian societies. We see it among other societies as well. So I'm not saying that this concept is the source of all bad behavior, but it certainly helps promote it, helps promote human cruelty to other humans as well as other creatures. So what does the word evil come from? During early biblical times, Jewish attitudes toward the word which stands for evil, which in Hebrew is ra, I had to look this up in places I never thought I'd go looking, later translated as evil in the English translations of the Bible, were different from those that would eventually form a cornerstone of doctrine in many Christian denominations. Ra, the Hebrew word that was translated in the English Bibles as evil, meant primarily worthlessness or uselessness. This is a quotation from a social anthropologist. The truth is that the early Hebrews did not discuss evil very much. Even today, the Encyclopedia Judaica has no entry under the heading evil. That is, the society that first used the word in the story of the Garden of Eden, the ancient Israelites, did not use a word, did not have a concept, did not make use of a concept of evil. That was added to Western society as something borrowed from Manichaeism, which was a Persian religion that goes back before Christianity. And evil was never a metaphysical principle in opposition to God in the Hebrew Bible. So that led me to understand and to follow through and see that Jewish translations into English of the Garden of Eden story don't talk about the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They talk about the tree of the knowledge of good and bad. So I had to look up the word ra as being a word that meant bad. And what did bad mean in the context of the Bible? And among the different things it meant were this. Accordingly, in Jewish and non-sectarian translations of the Eden story, the English word chosen for ra typically is not evil, it is bad. As the theological lexicon of the Old Testament says, ra can be neutral with no ethical accent. It need not state anything more than the fact that something is inappropriate. And when it's used to refer to land, it means that the land is infertile. It's like, that's bad land, that's infertile land. The word that the Hebrews used for good when applied to land also meant that's good land. It's productive. It will yield crops. Now, that triggered some thoughts in my mind, which was that, if you remember the story, the tree is called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And actually, that's not a great translation either. Closer translation is the tree of the knowing of good and bad. The tree of knowing good and bad is really the best translation according to Hebrew scholars. And knowing, as we know in the Bible, is a euphemism for sex. It's often used that way in the Bible. It's often used that way in other ancient Near East languages. So what's knowing good and what's knowing bad? What's good knowing? What's bad knowing? And that led me to an understanding that good knowing meant sex that makes babies. Bad knowing meant sex that doesn't make babies. Once people understood that pregnancy was a result of intercourse with a man, pregnancy in a woman happened only following intercourse with a man, and only if there was seminal release in the woman's vagina. Without that, no babies. Now, that wasn't a guarantee that the woman would become pregnant, of course. We know that. It depends when that happens. But the woman knew when she might be fertile. The man didn't. Human females have what's called hidden, something like what would be called hidden estrus. That is, the man cannot tell when the woman is fertile. The woman might know, but the man might not. Nevertheless, the woman came to understand from her own body what it was that she was causing pregnancy. And that alone was left open the question of what is the relationship between men and women when it comes to pregnancy. The possibilities for interpreting that information are broader than the ones that became adopted in the ancient Near East. There's an anthropologist named Carol Delaney who's written extensively about how even to modern times in the ancient Near East, agriculture is looked upon as a metaphor for birth. You've heard the word plowing as a slang word for intercourse. You've heard the concept of the man planting his seed, spreading his seed, as a reference to intercourse. All of these things reveal that in the ancient Near East and elsewhere as well, men have used and applied a concept of sex and reproduction, which identified the man as the source of the creative substance and the woman as merely the fertile, nurturing substance, providing just the fertile location for the seed. Now, what that says is, what that said to men in the ancient Near East was that men have the power to create babies. And there was a time when you can imagine, if you go back deep enough into history, that men might not have known that. Can you imagine that? I mean, think of the time between infertilization and birth. Think of the time even between fertilization and pregnancy. Think of the time even between fertilization and the interruption of menstruation. It doesn't happen all the time, even after sex. It happens some of the time. Some of the time the baby comes to term, sometimes not. It took quite a lot of cognitive and observational power for human beings to understand the connection between sex and pregnancy. But the first to understand it, according to the Garden of Eden story, was women. And the reason I say that is because if you remember, the first person to eat the so-called forbidden fruit was the woman, was Eve. So when I read the story, I begin to see something which is interestingly parallel to a likely evolution of consciousness about reproduction in humans in that part of the world. First, women understand that they have to receive, oh, by the way, the fruit. Let's talk about the fruit for a minute. The fruit that's usually visualized as an apple. And the reason for that is not because there was ever an apple mentioned in the Bible. There never was an apple mentioned in the Bible. There were no apples in the ancient Near East. It was a coincidence between the Latin word for apple and the Latin word for evil. It's the same word. And when the Romans had contact with Christianity, when the Roman Emperor Constantine converted, in fact, to Christianity and made Christianity from an alien and punishable religion to the official religion of the Roman Empire, Latin became the only permissible language for the Bible to be published in, written in, and read in. But because it was Latin, the idea of apple entered the culture. And the only real clue in the story about the fruit is the fact that after it was eaten, Adam and Eve covered themselves with a fig leaf. And if you could imagine a fig rather than an apple, you've seen ripe figs. You know that they're filled with seeds. You know what shape they are. All you have to do is hold two of them together in your hand by the stem, and you can see why the fig would be the perfect symbol for how women are fertilized by a man. So that's the visual part of how the story made sense to me. The language also makes sense, and the plot makes sense to me as a potentially historical clue to what was going on and what this story was about. The plot is that the male god, Yahweh, creates this garden, creates man, first for, of course, man, creates a woman out of the body of man, the opposite of what we all know is the way it really goes. No creature comes out of the body of man, but in this story, that's the way it's portrayed. So that's a patriarchal clue right there. Now, some people say it doesn't matter who came first, and I can understand that argument. It doesn't be coming second, I mean, being the second created rather than the first created. And maybe there are people who argue, oh, well, God saved women for last, saved the best for last. But I think there's something going on in that story, which is saying that not so much who came first and who came last, but who was the source of life and who was the product from that source. So male God first creates man. Then out of the man's body comes a woman, and they become partners. But after the woman learns about sexual reproduction and man's role in procreation, nothing much happens other than that she shares the information with the man. Then, if you forgive the phrase, all hell breaks loose. Because then things change. Everything changes. From being naked and unashamed, both the man and the woman feel ashamed. They're also afraid of God now. They hide. And my understanding of why that happened was not that they were ashamed of their body, but that they were violating a taboo of a kind which existed at the time, where human beings didn't have the power to create new life. Only God had the power to create new life. For humans to discover that they had that power was something that I think of as the mother load, the bonanza of biotechnology. Can you imagine being a relatively innocent individual, a human being without the knowledge of any technology, simple information about how the world works, observation of nature, of course. But if you discover that you have the power to do what you've thought only was a divine power, that could scare the pants off you, so to speak, or scare the pants onto you. And I think that's what that's talking about. The shame there is not a physical shame. The shame is something else, something like awe, something like fear of having violated a taboo, a very deep taboo, that is to usurp a divine power from the divine. And what changed in society was a series of things, which I think I'll read from the King James Version for a minute. By the way, when I started talking here, when I thought about talking here, before I do that, read from the Bible, I wondered whether the people who speak to the Atheist Society all feel like I do, that I'm preaching to the choir. Because I'm going to say something about the Bible that isn't usually said about what its meaning is. And it's a secular meaning, and it's a meaning based on what I understand about evolutionary principles and something about archaeology and what's happened in the history of humanity. So let me take a look at the King James Version. After the fig leaves are put on, it says, by the way, I'm curious, how many of you have actually read with your own eyes or heard with your own ears this story read to you? Is there anyone who hasn't? Oh, okay, interesting.
The essence of it.
The essence of it. And those, you hear it being talked about, but never examined the exact language or went into it. Well, I didn't either. But because I was a child who was puzzled by it, and because I was an evolutionary psychologist, and I thought that the Garden of Eden story is a competitor for everyone's belief system about where we come from and why we're here and how it got to be this way, I thought that there is something to look into there. Even though I don't agree with it as history, I wanted to know what it was actually telling people. And before I read the text in English, I'd say it's been telling people a lot of very different things over the centuries. What it was saying to the Israelites, to me, as I read it, is very different than what Christianity took from it. And the whole idea of good and evil, the whole idea of Satan being a part of the story is not part of the Jewish version of that story. But the other thing that I came to believe was that even the Jewish version that's written in Hebrew was actually a stolen story that I believe existed before the Bible was written, but which was disturbing to the patriarchal order. And you'll see why after I go a little bit further. So, the Lord God said to the woman, "What is it that thou hast done?" And the woman said, "The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat." Eat is what the metaphor is being used for gaining the knowledge that was contained in the fruit. And the serpent, let's take a moment to talk about the symbolism of the serpent. In Christian symbology, the serpent is identified as a manifestation, a form that Satan takes, and is identified with evil. In the ancient Near East, there were a lot of different associations about a serpent. And one of the other primary ones, which is quite opposite, is that the serpent was a symbol of the continual, perpetual regeneration and renewal of life. Because the snake was observed, like no other animal, to climb out of a dead skin, leave the shell of a dead body behind, and emerge renewed. So not only was the serpent, because of that unique property that it had, something that could inspire a belief that this could be the symbol for, or this could be regarded as a symbol of the continual renewal of life, but because of that, serpents were also predominantly associated with women and not with men in the symbology of the ancient Near East. And you can understand why. Because long before men were understood to be a part of the renewal of life, women were. Because, of course, babies come from women. So, the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, that is, beguiled the woman and persuaded her to eat the fruit, unto the serpent said, because thou hast done this, thou hast cursed above all cattle and above every beast in the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. What that would be understood as to a listener in the ancient Near East, I'm saying, is that that symbol of procreation associated with women and the goddess is now reviled. That symbol is dust. That symbol, eat dirt. You've heard the phrase, the sort of curse, eat dirt. Well, it goes back quite far. And that's an anti-feminist statement, in my view. And then it says, I will put enmity between thee, that is the serpent, and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. Meaning, in this case, seed means offspring, because seed could mean either the source of the offspring or the offspring. So it's saying that now the woman and the symbol of life's procreation will be alienated from each other. Another way of saying that the process of life's renewal will now become an alien function, a relationship of strain and alienation rather than harmony. And it'll become clear soon why. Unto the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. Now, more modern English translations of the Bible changed that statement. And the translations, after a while, in more modern translations, leave out the increase in the number of babies. And that's important. That's a very important part of the story, and very important that it stay in there. It's in the early translations in English, but not in the later ones. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow, he says to the woman, God says to the woman, and multiply your conceptions. She will have more babies, and they will be born in sorrow. Now, that's been interpreted as these are labor pains, because there wasn't an understanding of what was going on here. And it wasn't, I don't know that it was just ignorance or it was what I would call a cover-up of what's really going on. Thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over you. And that's the crux of the matter. There it is, a divine justification for the monogamous patriarchal family. Now that men have learned that they are participants in the process of procreation, and they've interpreted that as being the sole creative agent, the sole source, of creative substance. Nobody knew about the woman's ovum, or nobody recognized it at that time. No, there was never any scientific proof, of course, at that time. There were theories in Greece. Some people thought that the woman provided a seed as well as the man. Some people did not. Aristotle was one of those in Greece who thought that there was no female seed and only a male seed. And it seems that that also was adopted by the ancient Israelites. So, unto Adam, he says, now we've got, well, here what we've got so far. We've got woman alienated from the symbol of her procreation. Well, I can understand why. She hasn't got control of it anymore. She's got more children than she can safely bear, because it was life-threatening to have children. It's risky to be bearing children at that time. It's still risky today, but we have the medical means for protecting women to some degree. Something very profound is shifting in the society that's being described here. And for the man, it means, or for most men, it means, now you've got to feed more mouths. Yes, you've got more babies, and in a way you can say, I have brought forth more offspring. It's a kind of a machismo badge of honor in lots of societies. The more offspring you have, the more manly you are. But it also means that you've got to feed them. And one might wonder, why would anyone want to work harder to produce more offspring? Why would men want this outcome? And my answer to that is an evolutionary answer. Among all mammals, there's a tension between the interest of the female and the interest of the male in the number of births that are desirable. This is true of mammals, but also of birds. It's true for any species that invests a great deal of time in the nurturance of the offspring in order for them to survive. Evolution favors a number of offspring that is relatively stable in numbers, rather than wildly fluctuating, and certainly not perpetually and exponentially growing. Because you run into trouble if your population is growing exponentially. If you have more offspring than the number of parents participating in parenting, you've got an exponentially climbing population. And that immediately challenges your capacity to sustain that population. Natural resources get exhausted. Food is exhausted. Human beings began as called hunter-gatherers and remained that way for tens of thousands of years. There's a limit to how much you can gather with your hands. There's a limit to how much you can hunt. And if your population is growing and you intensify your hunting or you intensify your gathering, eventually the resources run out. The population of prey diminishes, or the amount of land you need goes beyond what you can manage. You've got to invent something to solve that problem if you're going to keep wanting to grow your population. And what was invented, which is understood by anthropologists and archaeologists, is agriculture. That is a technology for not only planting seeds, but for learning how to eliminate the weeds and eliminate the predators and produce a yield that's large enough to continually produce a support a growing population. And agriculture began slowly at first with the cultivation of fruit trees that goes back thousands of years. There are remnants, there's fossilized figs that have been found in the ancient Near East that go back thousands of years, that are only of a variety that's been cultivated by humans. We know how long it's been that agriculture has been going on. We know how long it's been that the population of humans on Earth has been growing, and the two correspond roughly with each other. And the Bible talks about, unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, shouldn't have listened to your wife, it says. And you've eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Because of that, cursed is the ground for your sake. In sorrow thou shalt eat of it all the days of your life. Meaning, and also thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat from the herb of the field, meaning grain. Grain agriculture, it was the invention in the ancient Near East to solve the population problem. And in the sweat of thy face eat bread, till thou return to the ground. And Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil. Now, there's a lot of theories about what that phrase means. Like one of us to know good and evil, godlike. That was the warning. The serpent said, you're not going to die if you eat this fruit. The serpent said, but you'll become like gods. And what was meant by becoming like gods and knowing good and evil is knowing the difference between fertile and infertile sex. Knowing the importance of male insemination. But it was interpreted by the writers of the Bible and by other men in that area as a justification for male control over women's procreation. And that's going on to this day. To this very day, there's a battle between those who believe that men should have sole control over women's pregnancies and women should not. An absolutely outrageous claim that goes back this far based on what is considered sacred text. And that sacred text, I suspect, was really something that had to be transformed from a lament to a justification. What I'm saying is that in this story, which was once a lament, where women and the men who were doing the agriculture, the sweating in the field, the lower classes, saw what was happening, understood why it was happening, felt oppressed, told a story about how women first learned where babies come from. They shared it with men. After they shared it with men, things started changing. Men took control, both of their procreation and forced a population explosion on humanity. And that started a spiral of increasing population and the need for increasing technology to yield more grain from the earth. And it was bad. It was bad for people. Although agriculture is usually referred to as an advance, a technological advance. Just look at how many more people could live on Earth. But anthropologists know that people who were the first agriculturalists died younger, were shorter, suffered more disease, and actually lived with less food security than if they could follow herd animals, hunt them, gather vegetables and fruit where it was growing, seasonally, circulating in small bands, not requiring the ownership of property, but not having to labor. There's an anthropological study of contemporary hunter-gatherers that says that the average workday beyond what's necessary, the average amount of work per day required of hunter-gatherers in a decent environment for food and sustenance is about 4 hours a day. And that's Marshall Solins, an old study that's still referred to. So here we are today in a tremendously expanded population, struggling for survival in a way with the help of a vastly more complicated technological superstructure that we have to sustain and protect against enemies in order to be able to live. It's not exactly something that we might have chosen if we could look ahead at what's where we are and where it brought us. Certainly women wouldn't have chosen it. But the people who had the power, who had enough power to own land, defend land, have others work the land for them, had an interest in perpetuating this system. And that's the meaning I've eventually taken from the Garden of Eden story. It actually opened up a story to me, which I didn't know before. And I think it opened up a story which answers questions for anthropologists as well, or it might. There's a book about how agriculture began. There's several of them, there's a number of them, because it's one of the biggest questions in archaeology that exists. What started agriculture? We know that the first place was in the ancient Near East. It also began in China by the river and in Central America and so forth, elsewhere. But what started it in the ancient Near East is not agreed to yet, nor is what the story of the Garden of Eden means agreed to, interestingly, among scholars. And what excites me about what I learned from all this research is that there might inadvertently be a clue to what that history really was, how that started. And it may have had to do not with a change just in weather, which did happen, to promote the possibility of growing enough food in the ancient Near East through agriculture, but also something that changed in human consciousness about who controlled procreation and how that triggered a population explosion and a reliance on technology for survival. Remember that the discovery was a discovery in biotechnology. That's what we'd call it today if humans were now to discover how to make a baby. What biotechnology would seem more absolutely mind-blowing than that? And people had to digest that information, and they didn't handle it very well as it happened. So that brings us to today and all of our problems. And I'd be interested in, of course, knowing after we have a pause here, your reactions to this, questions, comments, and we can have a little discussion about it and see what you think. So thank you. It's a pleasure talking to you. I'm going to say one or two things further, and then let's talk. I'm of course interested in what your reaction is to what I said today. I'm certainly interested in clarifying anything that didn't come across clearly, and if something was hard to grasp or I take responsibility for that, not you. And if any of you have a question about something you didn't hear clearly, my guess is there's somebody else who also didn't hear it clearly also. So feel free to please say it. I'll also say two other things. All of this research happened over a period of years. And it's a totally amazing experience for me because I never expected to go delving into the Graduate Theological Union Library and haunting through the stacks of books for translations from various eras and various sources of this story in the Bible. But I think you can see how somebody interested in human evolution would find some some interest in looking for what this story is about, because it basically presents itself, if you read it in a secular rather than a religious way, as a story of human evolution, human social evolution. Yes?
I was just going to say that I read a lot prior books about, you know, the cults that preceded the Hebrew cult and the goddess. But your remark pointing up that period when it became Latin and the idea that this, because it's politicians right now, this issue, I mean, you got to give more and more money to Planned Parenthood, because they still talking about women having control of their own reproductive rights as being evil.
Absolutely.
And you're saying that word evil came in at the time when it got translated into Latin?
The time that Christianity became a part of the Roman Empire, became institutionalized as a church.
Because they did have all kinds of weird hang-ups about sex and how babies were.
Well, see, all societies have taboos and beliefs, some of which involve magical thinking, some of which involve limited understanding, some of which involve circumstances limited to that little group. All societies have taboos about sex of one sort or another. But the particular one that sex without reproduction is a sin.
Yeah.
Had to do, as I understand it, I'm not a great scholar of this, but had to do with Paul and Augustine.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that became introduced into Christian doctrine.
That's what I was thinking about.
Augustine struggled with this story all through his life, not that his life lasted that long, but he struggled with trying to understand this story, and different ideas came to him and were rejected and so forth. But eventually, Elaine Pagels is a scholar of religion from Princeton, wrote a book about this, and she described the arguments in the early church about the different meanings that could be given to this story. And she goes into great detail about the different arguments and who was arguing the different points of view. But the winner was the winner of a battle of beliefs. And the one that won was the one that identified the serpent as Satan and sex without procreation as evil. And, you know, there's a lot that can be said about how that was a function of Augustine's own frustration in his belief that his own sexual desire was distorting his capacity, diminishing his capacity to function on the spiritual side of life. And
well, now it becomes the implication that you're making connecting to the modern political situation is, for those of us who are been concerned about this for a number of years,
yes,
really relevant. I mean, the last election, everybody thought all Hispanics would vote for Hillary, and in fact, a third of Hispanics voted for Trump, and apparently it was because Hillary was so clear in that debate, saying,
that's right,
you know, it's women's decisions, it's women's rights, and
that's
it was all these Hispanic men that said, we're voting for Trump. And, you know, the film which I watched has been horrified to really figure this out.
But it's true that, that's right. That thread of belief within Christianity has had a very big effect on politics in this country, more than even other Christian countries in the world, where there's more, oddly enough and paradoxically, a greater separation between church and state in places like Italy, in terms of the beliefs of people, than in a country like this, where it's supposed to be part of our founding document. It's odd. Yeah.
I know a friend of mine used to always say the main thing that'll change the world and that will solve the issue of reproduction is the education of women.
Absolutely.
And particularly the education around this issue of, you know, it's my body and I'm the one who has to raise the kids, and I should have equal rights to the guy, rather than just being his breeding station.
That's right.
But beyond that, it also corresponds to the societies that are the most, what I would call barbaric, are the societies that denigrate women the most.
Yes.
And they're also extremely warlike.
Yes.
And they keep having a whole lot of kids and a whole lot of kids and a whole lot of kids. And you know, what changes is, in the developed countries where people do get educated, there's more of a sense of women's rights, and there's a declining birth rate. So
yeah.
The problem is definitely associated.
Yeah. Yes. I'm sorry, there was someone in the back with their hand. Yeah.
So you said women were the ones who became aware of the connection between pregnancy and sex.
Yes.
So, but women then informed men, and men started sort of controlling the reproduction cycle. Women didn't, I guess, have to share that information with men. So what was the motivation for women to do that, or participate and even help men control?
That's a mystery. And the question was, if men usurped control from women after women told them about the link between sex and procreation, why would women want to tell men about it? And of course, I don't know the answer exactly. My theory of it is, and maybe there's all kinds of information that anthropologists could share about things like this that I don't know. But what I would say, yes.
Oh, sorry, I'm sure one of the things was that women probably would be penalized, punished, you know, harshly if they were not able to reproduce, right? Because that was one of the obligations, and that was why women were supported and provided, you know, by men.
Well, that's also very interesting. I think there's a lot of possibilities. One of them might be that all it takes is one woman, one night, to share one of the secrets that women kept among themselves with a man. It's possible, it could happen. Men and women aren't born enemies in every respect, and they have intimate relations emotionally as well as sexually. And most societies, many societies, there are stories which are, especially creation stories, which are shared by the women that are different from the stories shared by men that have to do with reproduction often. But you know, you can keep a secret for so long, and it's possible that it slips out somewhere. And once that happens, this could be the outcome. Yeah.
Is there any evidence that in matriarchal societies, I assume that they existed at that time more than men, that any of the stories about Garden of Eden were present in those societies as well?
Well, the story of the Garden of Eden has no written precursor to the Hebrew Bible that is agreed upon by everyone. There are versions of the Garden of Eden story that are also part of Israelite society, which are not clearly dated. Some people say they may have been early versions. Some people say they were later variations on the Bible story. But outside, one of the interesting things is that there are some similarities of mythology from the ancient Near East and within Israelite society, but nothing as specific that matches the Garden of Eden story that's been written. So when I say I think there's a story that was orally transmitted, that's a speculation. I don't know. But I'll tell you one other reason why I believe that there was. There's a researcher who's an archaeologist who studied Assyria and the societies of the ancient Near East that preceded Israel. And she said that in those societies, women had the role, or among the roles for women, were lamentation. women would pray over the loss of loved ones mm-hmm. when they died. Women would also have ritual prayers for the destruction of a city in a war, or the destruction of a town through famine or some other mishap. So women had the role of being the lamenters over misfortune. And what I suspect is that the monotheistic patriarchal society of Israel did not want to tolerate the circulation of a story which regarded these developments as lamentable rather than God's will. You did it, you made the mistake, you're being punished. That's why, and this is the way things should be.
That's not my question. My question was the story present a matriarchal
society? Well, okay. There's a question as to whether there were any matriarchal societies. If what you mean is society that was dominated by women, most even feminist scholars that I've read say, no, there was nothing like a matriarchal society equivalent to a patriarchal society. There were societies where women were more prominent and had more equal status with men. Yes, there were societies. Oh yes, absolutely, all through the Middle East.
Yeah.
The monotheistic patriarchal society was a gradual evolution of societies that had both gods and goddesses. Several goddesses, several gods, gods for different functions, gods for different occasions, gods for different groups. That was very common. Gradually, some of these functions started to coalesce to all be assigned to one or two gods. One major god, one minor god. The major god might be a man, the minor god might be a woman. Further evolution of the culture might lead to the woman becoming more and more marginalized as a god figure, and the man being the only one. That's one of the narratives.
There are
matrilineal societies,
yeah.
but that's not the same thing as matriarchal, because that one refers to how descendants is traced. The other refers to who has power and who doesn't.
Aren't Jews
are a strange combination in the sense of matrilineal. They're patrilineal. The paradox is that if you look at the Bible and it's the Jews' story in the book of Genesis, after Adam and Eve leave the Garden of Eden and Cain and Abel start having babies, all of the descendants are traced only through men. And so-and-so begat so-and-so, and so-and-so begat so-and-so. All those things that are referred to as begats in the King James Bible are men. Men are the agents, and not women. But in modern times, and I don't know where this began, one is regarded as a Jew if their mother was Jewish. That's what you're referring to. I agree. I understand that.
The Russian Poland.
Huh?
The Russian Poland.
Is that the origin of that?
Yeah, because the Russians raped the Jewish woman. So you had to then...
If you wanted the woman's child to be honored as a Jew, you had to... Mm-hmm. I see. Yes?
In the second generation of Cain and Abel, we're talking about more women having more babies in agriculture.
Yes.
Being the means to sustain that.
Yes.
Cain and Abel, the battle.
Yes.
Says something about the Jews, because the Jews were not agricultural at the time. Cain is the agricultural farmer, and he's the bad guy.
You mean Cain is the killer? Cain is the murderer.
He's the farmer.
He's the farmer. I mean, farmer in the sense that not the herder, not the herder of animals.
The herder is the good guy. Right. He's done it.
Right.
So there's a real tension.
But the herding of animals is also a development beyond farming and beyond hunting, because that requires some control over land, not quite as strict as growing crops would be. But I don't know about the puzzles contained in that particular wrinkle. Yes?
Just one question about language. about Aramaic. Does that figure in? You're talking about Hebrew.
Yeah. Most, the Hebrew Bible is written in Hebrew.
Okay.
A lot of the Christian Bible or New Testament was also in Aramaic, as well as Greek, at least the sources of it.
Yeah.
And there may be some Aramaic in the Hebrew Bible. I really am not sure, but very little.
The other question was about fertility and open population. I thought early cultures, because the women nursed for many years sometimes, there was much more population control, that there wasn't that much problem with overpopulation.
Yes. Yes. I mean, women. It's in women's interest, on behalf of the long-term benefit of their offspring, as well as of the community. Although it's not conscious, it's evolved as what you might call an instinct. The women and their need to keep the young baby alive through nursing have an interest and a stake in both having fewer babies by whatever means necessary, but what's evolved is that during lactation, they're less fertile, if that's what you're referring to. And if they nursed a long time, they would be less fertile. And that's true. And that exercises some limit on the number of children they could have. But they might actually wish to limit the number of births beyond just their biological capacity to have them, because of the labor involved in caring for children before they're fully independent. I mean, long beyond nursing stage, even if they nurse for several years rather than just a few months, they still, if they are the ones primarily responsible for caring for children, while the man and his male children are out working the fields, her labor is harder to the degree there are more children. Yes?
I have a question. Do we have a sense of when women first came to understand the connection between... No? Because I'm curious to understand how these cultures kind of began to form these origin stories around what they came to realize was the connection between sex and pregnancy.
Very interesting. But I think there are studies, see, without, it's sort of a precious accident that by peeling the meanings off the Christian Bible, you arrive at an understanding of what the Hebrew Bible might have meant. By looking at that meaning, you might suspect meanings that preceded it.
Mm-hmm.
But unless you have something in writing, it's very hard to know how far back, to go that far back into narrative. There is no narrative history.
Mm-hmm.
There's mythology, which sometimes gives clues. But unless the society had a written language, unless they had an elite which wrote a language, it has to be a big society to have writing. And most of them weren't that size. And most of them weren't that early. So most hunter-gatherer societies wouldn't have had a written language, and that understanding would have happened early during hunting and gathering times.
Which dates were the Hebrew Bible written down?
There's argument about that. It's not entirely agreed upon. It's a span of up to 800 years from what are believed to be the earliest books in the Hebrew Bible to the latest books in the Hebrew Bible. But the Eden story, some people have thought it was something like 900 to 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. Others have argued that it's about 500 years. That's right. That's right. And I don't know the answer, because they're still arguing about it among themselves, and I haven't chosen to try and figure that out. We'll look into it. Yes.
So the domestication of animals goes back about 10,000 years.
Yes. So does agriculture.
But you would imagine that the knowledge that males are required for offspring would be pretty much simultaneous with that, once you're keeping flocks.
Yes.
So that goes back really far. So does that whole notion of the secret of men being required for procreation, that's like a good span of thousands of years before the Hebrew Bible.
Yes.
Dreamed up.
Yes. Yes. I think there are a lot of people who have written that the knowledge of the connection between sex and reproduction was based on observation of herd animals.
Sure, it stands to reason.
It stands to reason that might be so. Herd animals, first of all, you have to have, you'd have to be a human being willing to identify with a herd animal and say the story for them is similar to the story for me. I don't know to what degree. Well, they have some of the anatomy. That's true. That's true. That's true. And it's possible that this story, the story about women getting the knowledge first, goes back earlier, maybe even earlier. Now, here's something interesting. There are anthropologists who have studied myths, which they can prove are historically accurate. They're in poetic language, but that they recount an actual historic event. That, in one case, in fact, there's a story of the Klamath Indians, who have a story about the formation of Crater Lake. And the story they have was told to explorers a couple of hundred years ago, maybe, and the explorers wrote it down. And it, Europeans who came to the West Coast. And it talked about fiery objects falling from the sky, things erupting in balls of fire, the crater collapsing and water forming. And you can geologically date when this thing happened. And it's 8,000 years after they collected the story. So it's known from that and other such evidence, as well as things like the Upanishads and the Hindu story that people can memorize vast amounts of poetic material and transmit it generation after generation for thousands of years. Yeah.
The 800 years that you say that it's right in the Bible.
Yeah.
What, in terms of what most religious historians think, what is the most common from date and to date in that 800 years?
Well, I think the 800 years presumes an early story, one of the earlier written stories, to be about 900 to 1,000 years before the birth of Jesus, to about 200 years before the birth of Jesus.
I'm just saying when it was written down.
Yeah, when it was written down. That's right. These were collected stories. I mean, as people have said, the Bible is a library.
So the most current book in the Torah is...
Would probably be, yes, before the birth of Christ, yes. Yes?
Just anecdotally, if you're saying that women figured out that it was to their advantage to have fewer children rather than many, other than lactation at that time,
How do they accomplish? Well, you can accomplish it by declining to participate.
Yeah, but I can't imagine.
You don't think that women would have the capacity to do that?
I don't think that would have been much of an option. I mean, it was obviously very patriarchal.
That was the scandalous thing that the Romans did, was all kinds of sex without the kind of intercourse that could
without penetration.
Yeah, that's what St. Augustine hated. They were doing all this nasty stuff and no babies.
Also, there's I mean, others here may know more about this than I do, but I'm pretty sure that women had all kinds of herbal methods that were understood by them. That would be the kinds of things that women would develop knowledge of over time and keep it to themselves.
Women who were captured by...
Yeah.
Yes. Americans,
yes.
Often were taken back and escaped again. The ones who wrote about it, one of the things that they loved about the Native American society was they had control over when they had the...
Really? That's interesting. That's interesting. Yeah. Yes?
Have you thought to write your own version of the Garden of Eden based on more accurate translation? Because, you know, there are all these, like, rhymes.
Yeah. What would it look like? Well, it's a good question. I'm working on a book, and somewhere in the book, I haven't taken this on because that's quite a challenge. Because the story is told in so few words, it's a miraculous piece of literary art to be able to take a story of historic events over which could have transpired over thousands of years and boil it down to the number of lines that is in the story of the Garden of Eden in the Bible is, as literary people say, it's an amazing thing. It's an amazing feat, whoever did it. And I think there's also talk about why that was done, why it was compressed. I would try to compress it, but I'm more verbose than the average biblical writer. But what I did do is I wrote a lot of songs about it. And this is an odd development. I'm a sort of amateur songwriter. And in the course of doing all this research, I found myself thinking of songs that expressed my version of the story. And I could play one or two for you. I'd like to do that. The CDs are here. They're available for purchase. If you want to hear my story in song, words and songs, I can provide it. Just for fun.
Just reading it, I can't grasp your song.
Oh, no. I have lyric sheets. Yeah. Now I talk. Here.
Could we do one at a time and then maybe have some more discussion?
Yeah, sure. Yes, sir.
Just before you get to that, I just wanted to ask, could you comment on the myth or the story that Amazon was supposed to be related to matriarchal society?
I understand. The women were portrayed as warriors and so forth. I don't know anything about it, so I can't help. I can't help you with that. Yes.
I have to ask this question. That's only half serious. You told us the story of the Garden of Eden, and the serpent was condemned by God because he had been disobedient and was condemned to eat dirt and crawl on his belly forever. Does that imply that before being cursed by God, the serpents walked upright?
Not that they walked upright, but some people have said that there are reptiles with feet. I mean, there are also reptiles. There are lizards, and in some of the paintings during medieval time and even Renaissance time, I think the serpent is painted as, well, there's all varieties, painted as a lizard-like being with legs, supposedly before it was cursed, and also painted with the head of a woman as a way of linking Satan to women. Yeah, that's right. So I'll tell you, yes.
Our guide mentioned that the government is pushing people to have smaller families. In the past, they wanted to have lots of kids because the child mortality rate was so high. And now that they have clinics and all that all over, and it's reduced drastically, so they don't need to have so many kids.
Yes. What happens is that once you have an agricultural society, you can't survive without a lot of children to take care of the fields. And women have to buy into that as well, especially if it's a patriarchal society by then. Women have to go along with it.
Where do you get the idea that they don't want to have children?
Where do they get the idea?
Where do you get the idea that they want to have
fewer children? It's in the it's an analysis of the evolutionary pressures on males and females throughout the mammalian order. That is, well, it's not a conscious thing. What I'm saying is that through all mammals have, in the case of subhuman mammals or non-human mammals, they have an estrous cycle, which means they can only bear a child in limited periods of time. That is one way. In other words, they evolve various means in the female for limiting births, whereas the male is capable of producing sperm anytime there's a receptive female. And what they say biologically to understand what's going on is that for whatever reason, the evolutionary solution to wanting the capacity to grow the population when necessary, but limit the population when necessary, was solved by having men always ready to breed and women selectively being participating in the breeding. Not consciously, not through beliefs, but throughout the mammalian order. In other words, it's a biological evolved instinctive. Yes, the biological limitation. In humans, consciousness becomes involved in this. That is, we become aware and have feelings about things that we can articulate, but it doesn't mean that we're not also subject to that evolution or products of that evolution. It's hard to.
Yeah, but.
Okay. Well, I would.
You're familiar with parental investment theory, right?
Pardon me? Yes, that's what I'm referring to. That's what I'm referring to.
I interpret that as, in a sense, women desiring to reproduce things.
Well, mathematically, optimizing the number of offspring that survive, women want to have larger spaces.
Yeah.
But men are going to want to have as many as they can get.
Yeah. But that's still, basically the same thing they would want to do with yourself.
Do you mean emotionally?
Yeah. Or behaviorally, yeah.
Can we make a comment about that? I think right now we're looking at a time historically, the last 50 years, that suggests that what you're thinking is not correct, because women are becoming more in control. And they're choosing not to have as many children because of that. So it's not worldwide, because there are still societies that live under the pressure of more. But
yes, there are societies where they have the control, they make the choice.
Particularly,
as far as population, the growth is going down.
Cross-Christian, Methodist, Catholic, all of them. It wasn't the woman's choice. I mean, for example, the Kennedys. I can remember a statement that Mrs. Kennedy told Joseph, the old man, that's it. She had eight. I've given you enough. I'm not having any more. And my feelings are, most women would say that if they had the choice.
Actually, I think it's not linked to control, because in developing countries where they've given lots of contraception, the birth rate does not go down. What's linked to the birth rate going down is female education.
Yeah. Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
It's not control.
And when you have education, you have.
But how does education relate when you relate to control?
Yeah.
Well, no, I'm not saying it's not controlled by having availability of contraception, or it's that they have, because women get a lot of prestige and satisfaction. If they're not doing anything else with their life, having a lot of kids is great. Even if it's a burden, unless a woman has some other thing to do with her life.
Well, right, okay. Yeah. So the context, the cultural context makes a big difference, as well as the means of survival.
Right.
All of those things would make a big difference. If you're living in an agricultural society and you cannot keep the farm going unless you have lots of children, the woman as well as the man understands those forces that are operating and would want to have the children as much as necessary, yeah. I would think.
There's another factor here that really applies to more modern times, and that is that every society now has a monetary system. So you have a lot of kids and it costs you money to feed the kids, raise them, and that sort of thing. Back in the old days, before there was money, it was just a matter of having enough food. It's different now. The turf is different. And you can make the argument and say, well, more money, you have money to buy it. It still doesn't play out quite the same way, because it's like this intermediate thing. Money now playing this role of wanting, of determining, helping to determine how many kids you can have.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Money, if money is the resource whereby you can decide what size family can you manage or do you wish to have, it's different than in a society that is having to make those decisions based on direct connection with the means of survival rather than a monetary system and a placement in a class system. It's very different.
Do you hear the song?
Yeah, songs. Okay. Well,
did you have a question?
As far as I understand, the difference in the strategy between men and women, for the women, when you take care of the children and devote more to that one child, that increases the survival
child. That's right.
They tend to favor taking care
of that's the parental investment theory that you're talking about, that he was, this gentleman was talking about.
Whereas men want to have as many by.
Yes. I think we understand it ourselves. Well, let's see. I'll play a tune that, this is all different kinds of music. This is blues. It's nasty. It's a way of putting words in the mouth of the man who's discovered that he's got the secret for how to make more babies. And
sounds like blues.
It's a blues. It's called "Who's Your Dad?"
Queen, on your terracotta throne, thinking of my flesh and blood as an extension of your own, handing out the miracle with your medicine brew, hearing the voice of the oracle speaking only to you. But who's your daddy? Who's your the mystical body, you that held the scales, the secrets and the stories, and the serpents by their tails, and I was nearly invisible, now it's your turn to disappear, playing second fiddle, taking up the rear, gonna lose your daddy, lose your daddy now. them and you made them sacred shrines. You brought these abominations brazenly to my door. But alien tools and the magic of fools ain't coming in here no more. Cause who's your daddy? Who's your daddy? Who's your
Why, thank you. Now, there's songs here about learning about it in the first place, the man learning about it, a little more innocent at that stage. There's another song that's a quieter one. I'll play for you. It's actually number 11. It's called If Memory Serves Me Well.
Breathe the airwaves, their cry of till the moon shines light as bright as the sun. And they see that love is where living comes from.
Say that violin played by a fellow sitting right up here had a lot of help. On that song is a woman named Linda Hirshhorn, who's a Berkeley singer, who's an old friend of mine. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Pleasure. No, that's for you. Anybody who wants the lyrics, they're free. If you want a CD, they're for sale. And it's been a pleasure.
How much are the CDs?
CDs are 15, but for you, a special deal, sir, for the video. Okay. tonight only. Well, thank you. It was a pleasure having you here. Thanks a lot.
I understand. I'll tell you something. I began with that assumption, and I still think it's important for people who are looking for a different meaning than the one that they've been offered about Adam and Eve's story, for instance. That it clarifies, reinforces, and reaffirms and validates some of what they like to believe and what they do believe is the truth about our past. So it's still important for the choir to hear their song being sung rather than the other one. But I also think that there are people now, maybe increasing numbers of people, who feel that they have some religious belief, but they don't believe everything they heard from religious sources, and would welcome, even though they may maintain a belief in a religion, welcome the story that I told about the Garden of Eden as being useful information and perhaps true information. And that's a step forward in terms of consciousness. So I'm happy to speak about it anyway.
Because